Welcome back to Comics Are Awesome, where we bring you everything awesome in comics. Today's comic is Quantum and Woody by Christopher Priest and M.D. Bright. But I have a problem. You see, this comic deals with two major components. Friendship and racism. And I don't know if you've noticed, but I'm a Midwestern comic nerd. I don't have any qualifications to talk about either of these subjects. Maybe it's time I finally do a crossover. But with who?
Too scary. Too white. Too ethnic. Too excitable. Not excitable enough. Too obscure.
Ah, girl!
Last time I checked, he was possessed by a red lantern ring, so that's a maybe. I have no idea who that is. Too intelligent. Also, see previous Scream.
What would they know about being an ethnically diverse duo who fight the forces of evil? I don't know. None of these seem right. Maybe I should just give it... Wait a second. I've got an idea. People of the internet, I introduce you. Please ignore all the other times he's appeared in the background of my videos. Comic Cat! Comic Cat is going to help me out on all my reviewing misadventures and dispense his valuable wisdom. Say hello, Comic Cat. I am so excited I finally get a chance to talk about this book. This is one of the very first non-Marvel or DC comics I ever got into.
In 1989, former Marvel editor-in-chief Jim Shooter helped create a new comic company called Valiant Comics. They created a new universe of superheroes, including Exo, Manowar, Archer and Armstrong, and Shadow Man. But eventually the company's investors decided to sell off Valiant to Acclaim, publisher of video games like NBA Jam and the Mortal Kombat series.
Yeah, a company that's primarily known for one form of media adopting a whole new type? Yeah, I'm sure that's gonna end well.
Well, actually, Acclaim's time as a publisher lasted longer than I would have guessed. The new Acclaim comics published from 1996 to 2000. But still, the Acclaim universe died young despite having a few well-loved titles, including today's subject, Quantum and Woody.
Doing a linear plot summary of this book is kind of tricky, because this book jumps around in time like Tarantino in a TARDIS.
Our heroes are Eric Henderson and Woodrow Van Shelton, also known respectively as Quantum and Woody. Eric and Woody grew up as friends in the preppiest prep school that ever prepped. The two had several misadventures in their youth, usually instigated by the mischievous Woody. Stuff like feeding a Valium doggy treat to their neighbor's mud, or spying on Eric's schoolboy crush, Amy Fishbean, only to discover they're looking in Amy's mother's window. Eric likes to talk up his proud African heritage, but Woody likes to remind him that only the cotton you've ever picked was the lint balls out of your drawers.
I know. That makes Woody sound a bit racist. Yeah, a little bit. But that doesn't mean he doesn't care for his friend. Woody just doesn't have respect for authority. Or color, or creed, or any type of thing that you can hide behind. He judges people as individuals, for better or worse.
Not surprisingly, race is a large part of this book. While it's not ultimately about race or racism, keep in mind this was a 90s book created by two African-American artists and featured an African-American main character. It was bound to come up, but the way they do it is not in a preachy manner. In fact, they took a lot of effort to poke fun at racism, such as when they break the fourth wall and address the audience directly, letting them know that they'll be replacing offensive language with things like F-word or S-word, and the all-dreaded N-word being replaced with noogie. Seeing someone say, my noogie, is not only hilarious, but also highlights how certain words have power, power that can be stripped away in the right context. Anyways, Woody's parents divorced, and he chose to live with his mother, not realizing that he'd be living in destitution and having no easy way to contact his friend. Eric, meanwhile, never knew why Woody left. And over time, an offhand comment from someone else became twisted in his head, and Eric started to believe that Woody left because he was racist against Eric.
I know it sounds a bit silly, but keep in mind Eric at the time was a teenager. Teenagers believe in stupid things. Like Justin Bieber, for example. Don't be silly! Bieber's just an invention of the great anti-Canadian smear campaign. Damn maple haters.
The two are reunited 15 years later at their father's funeral. They're not exactly happy to see each other. Eric, now a serious-minded West Point graduate, wants to investigate their dad's deaths. His primary suspect is Dr. Warrant, the top scientist employed by their fathers. Collaborating this is Eric discovering that two high-tech control bands in his father's sock drawer. Incidentally, I love Woody's reaction to this. There's a drawer just for socks? Woody forces Eric into letting him join the investigation, including taking one of the bands for himself. They follow Warrant to their father's lab, but Woody's clowning around and Eric's stick-in-the-mud attitude finally come to a head. They start fighting, Eric angry over feeling like his best friend abandoned him, and Woody resenting Eric acting like he was harmed while Woody was subjected to living in poverty with his mother. But when the testing area they've entered starts flooding with energy, and they see Dr. Warrant working the controls on the other side of the glass, well, they keep fighting.
It may seem a little stupid to continue to come to blows over petty bickering in the face of looming death. In reality, it's mind-blowingly stupid. Yeah, there's a reason why this book has the tagline of World's Worst Superhero Team.
With the testing chamber active, Eric and Woody's bodies slowly begin to dissipate, and yet they still continue to throw punches at each other until clang! The control bands they were wearing touch, and they wake up in a field, the building they were in now nothing but rubble.
If I had a dollar for every time... Yeah, science, bitches! Do a cake stand! What's that noise? Luckily for me, that both did and didn't happen at the same time. Thanks, Schrodinger!
Eric and Woody discovered that they are now bound by quantum energies. They must clang their armbands, which can no longer be removed, together once every 24 hours or their bodies begin to dissipate into energy. And now they're stuck with each other, with their father's alleged murder seemingly destroyed in the explosion.
Psst! He's not! They're actually really bad at this.
But it's Woody, surprisingly enough, who decides that they should be doing something more with their lives. Of course, Woody thought that meant handing out pamphlets or joining a neighborhood watch. Eric is the one who decides to not half-ass it and creates costumes for themselves. Eric becomes Quantum, armed with his military experience, hand-to-hand combat expertise, and countless gadgets and non-lethal weaponry. And armed with a Beretta and a Zippo lighter, Woody becomes known as... Woody.
And thus begins the crime-fighting careers of Quantum and Woody, the world's worst superhero team. And you know what? Wouldn't have it any other way.
While they may not be the most effective team in terms of crime-fighting, it doesn't mean they aren't doing good. Their first big case involves them trying to arrest a man for murder he legitimately didn't commit. But doing so involves fighting attack helicopters, ninjas, stopping the distribution of computer chips that can decrypt military codes, and threatening a goat in order to make monks give up their vow of silence. Don't worry, the goat's fine, and in fact they adopted it as a pet slash mascot.
Hey! Does anybody have a cat-sized cape? Oh.
Even though they sometimes blunder through things and sometimes cause as much destruction as they fix problems, they do generally save lives and help people. And that's important. If they were completely inept or only solved cases through pure luck, you'd likely grow tired of their antics, but they're not. The two actually have skills and balance each other out fairly well when they try. Quantum has loads of training, gadgets that would make Batman jealous, and his serious attitude keeps him focused on the job. But he's also prone to his imagination getting away from him. Woody makes a comment about wanting to do more with their lives, and he decides that that must mean tights and a cape. And this is before they even discover that their control bands shot force and energy beams. He also dreams of winning over his childhood sweetheart and grew up believing that his best friend moved away because he was racist. Woody, on the other hand, is irreverent, disrespectful, and generally more interested in thinking with his little Woody than being some noble champion of the downtrodden. And yet, he keeps Quantum grounded, unafraid to tell his partner that his hunch about an obscure dye is actually just Kool-Aid. He's also far more street-savvy than Eric will ever be. He can recognize a plainclothes cop on sight and has connections that can scare off gangbangers with a few words.
What? A wise-cracking, streetwise white guy and a serious-minded black guy from the upper crust? But that's the opposite of how Hollywood has taught me these things should be done! Why, it is as if somebody was trying to make a statement about how overused these tropes might be. Whatever. Sadly, the book only lasted 17 issues before it was canceled. But the story doesn't end there.
In 1998, Acclaim got out of the comic business, only for it to dip its toe back in 15 months later. So Quantum and Woody would return, but not with issue 18 or a brand new number 1, but instead picking up with issue 32, the issue that would have been released that month had the series never been canceled. It was part 3 of a 4-part story. After that, they returned with issue 18, the plan being then to fill in the gaps to what happened between issues 17 and 32, such as Woody being possessed by an evil force known as Dr. Eclipse, and Quantum having a new partner named Woody, who is a teenage black girl. It was a brilliant way of bringing people back to the book's return, and had it succeeded, it would likely be a milestone in comic book events. Sadly, it wasn't to be.
In early 2000, Acclaim Comics shut their doors for good, leaving Quantum and Woody sadly unfinished. Writer Christopher Priest would go on to write for Marvel Comics, including an acclaimed run on Black Panther that I plan on getting to at some point in the future. But as of right now, both Priest and artist M.D. Bright are retired from comics. But the story still does not end there.
In 2012, a new version of Valiant Comics started to publish rebooted versions of some of their previous titles, like Archer and Armstrong and Shadow Man. And starting in 2013, a brand new version of Quantum and Woody will be launched, this time with writer James Asmus and artist Tom Fowler. At the time of this filming, I obviously haven't read the new Quantum and Woody. What I have seen, however, seems to be different but promising. There have been changes made, like Eric and Woody are now adopted brothers, but I'm still willing to give it a chance. There aren't enough strong, character-driven comedy books out there. So if it sounds interesting to you, you might want to check it out.
Well, there you have it, folks. I think we all learned a valuable lesson today. I'm not entirely sure what that lesson was, but something about life, racism, I don't know. Anyways, go out and try the new Quantum and Woody, or go out and check out the old one. But remember, comics are awesome, and we're gonna get the word out. Ah!